So I figure I'll go over a few things that I've learned about making bases in a variety of categories, and we can just talk about how you guys make bases. And I can learn what you guys have done. So that's my secret plan, is to learn from you rather than to teach you. so I can get a little bit better at this. But now let's see. Let me read from my notes here. A lot of things that I've done are the usual things, like sticking an airplane on a plaque, you know, with the wheels up, or sticking a tank on a chunk of like grass and some dirt and things like that. But lately I've been breaking into doing mini bases for gaming minis and fantasy minis, and adding a lot of groundwork and things like that. So I'll be covering a little bit on that. One of the other things I think is important to talk about on bases is, if you're going to build a model into a base,
we also have airplanes out there on the flight line. The museum was gracious enough to move them out of here so we've got this space. But we're all on the flight line, so I think we'll have them there too.
So if you get,
what do you mean by building a model into a base?
Well, building it, what I mean by that is, if you're going to mount something to a base, a lot of people think, especially when it's like airplanes or science fiction models, I see a lot of people will build the model first and then try and figure out how to get it onto that base. And then it's a problem for them. They're like, okay, I've drilled a hole in it, and then I have a stick, so I stuck some putty up in there and I hope that it's going to stick. And the next thing you know, the model's kind of sitting there listless and spinning in the web. So
the base has to be part of the construction.
The base should be part of the construction process, and in fact, it should be the first part of the construction process. Like if you're building an airplane, usually the instructions say start with cockpit, or start with the wheel wells or something like that. No, you need to start with the base. Planning that out before you close your fuselage halves up. You know, build that mounting system. This is especially true if you're going to light things up and you're going to put electronics in it. You really have to do that before. You know, so that you can run your wires through your base, and so the base always comes first when you're doing this. So you have to think, what's going to happen 6 months from now when I finish this model? Do I want it to come off the base? Or do I want it to be permanently fixed onto the base so it's impossible to carry around? It's often, I find it's better to make it so that you can remove it from the base, which means either having nested tubing. I like to use square tubing on things because then things don't shift around. But if you're going to have rounded tubing, find a way to pin it so that it doesn't rotate.
Or have two of them.
Yeah, that's a good idea. Or one of the other things that I like to do is use mono audio jacks. So I'll build female plug into the model and the male plug into the base and plug it right in. It snaps right into place. And that way you can run your electronics through that audio jack.
Yeah, it's a good way to get rid of junk electronics too.
And you know, it's a really simple trick. You know, you have to think about things like, is it going to be massive enough to hold the model up? If you have a fairly heavy model and you have a nice light little foam base, is it going to fall over on the table and break something off all the time? A lot of people try and make things as light as they possibly can, and I don't see any need to do that. I think mass is your friend. If you can pick that base up and murder somebody with it, you're doing okay. You know, there's no reason to make things light. Those tables are strong. They'll hold things up. And I've never understood the attitude about, we've got to make this as light as we can. Well, you know, fill it up with resin. Make it heavy. Make it out of aluminum. Make it out of steel. Weight's your friend on that. That's my preamble. I have broken bases up into a couple of categories. One, flying bases, like we just talked about, where you build, you know, like you have an airplane or you have a spaceship. Spaceships are really common. I build a lot of spacecraft. And I wish I had brought a couple of more examples with me, but I like to make bases, especially for science fiction models, just scratch build them out of styrene. And you guys do a bunch of scratch building too?
Yeah.
I know you did, you know, your base that you were talking about. I'm sure you scratch built a lot of stuff, or did you use a lot of aftermarket stuff for that?
No, it was, the whole thing was scratch built.
You want to see?
Sure.
It's the same sort of thing that you would use for any other minor scratch building details. You sheet styrene, use a lot of evergreen, little aves, putty, or whatever your preferred putty is, Bondo, I don't care. But just build something up that's unique, that's not just a wooden plaque. And then you're in complete control of how that thing fits together. Like I said, I had planned on bringing another couple of examples, but I ran out of time. Anyway, that's flying bases, and we'll talk about that a little bit more in a discussion. And then there's ground bases, which are things like what you're talking about for cars and for tanks. Even aircraft that are just sitting on a tarmac or something like that. And so, you know, the materials that you're talking about there are foam or a wooden plaque or a plinth, or and then you can add all kinds of things to it, you know, expanded steel matting or plants or trees or flowers. I like to add a lot of grass. You guys ever add grass to any bases?
I wouldn't call it a base. I put it down and put it on it.
Put it on it, yeah.
It.
Okay, do you, you missed the very beginning of it. When you put things on it, do you fix your model to the base, or you just say not fix? Okay,
yeah.
That's what you prefer?
Yeah. I'm about here,
mm-hmm.
and I don't exhibit, so they stay at the house.
Okay,
Sometimes it's a hurricane, and sometimes it's another one. So it's like swap them out sometimes.
Right. Yeah. I won't presume to say one way is right and one way is wrong, because both have their place. I like to leave them unfixed myself, because it makes them easier to carry around. If I need to carry a model to a show, and it's fixed to, you know, I got a big model, it's sitting on a big base, like clunky, and it's asymmetrical, and it's hard to box up. If I can take the model off the base and put it in a box, and take the base and put it in another box or next to it, it's a lot easier to move around. That's just one consideration. And I've learned that the hard way. So,
one thing I found grading the ARCs and Goodwill shops is I found picture frames that are about that big.
Mm-hmm.
Well, it's great for putting craters and ditches and having three dimensions
on
your base.
Yeah, it is. Yeah. And it has the added effect, if you're going to add lights to something or other electronics,
you've
got a place underneath there for your circuit board, batteries, or at least a wall board or something.
Because I found them from one vehicle size to almost, you know, small diorama size.
Yeah.
And they're about, you know, three-inch walls on them.
Yeah.
Now, this is great, like I say, for putting stuff underneath or building ditches and craters. And
yeah.
That's funny, because I've been looking for that online, and I found it hard to find.
Go to ARC, Goodwill, hit their picture frame section.
Yeah, if you, or you can just go to like Michael's or, you know, any of the hobby shop. I've got a base I've been working on for a AFV that it isn't finished yet, but it's the same sort of thing that you're talking about. This isn't a picture frame, it's just a piece of foam, just a piece of pink insulation foam, and I kind of like walled it off with sheet styrene, and then let's just go ahead and go over some of the details on what I did with this. The first thing I did was I made a bunch of mud out of mud. I took, you know, I bought a sifter from King Supers, and I just sifted dirt out of my backyard until it was really fine. I mixed it up with some Mod Podge, you know, just PVA glue and some water and a little bit of brown paint, and blocked that all over this thing.
And that's the difference in color. You took the paint.
Well, then I
painted a little darker here.
Then I painted everything. But you know, I just mixed it in with some dark color to give it a dark base. You know, I carved out this trench in here before I added any of that. So I carved that stuff all out of the foam, and spackled everything over with that mud. Let that dry, and then I added static grass. This is the only model I've used static grass using a static gun on.
Okay.
And I like static grass with a static gun, but I think I prefer to glue it in with clumps, mm-hmm. where I'll take a little bit of grass in a pair of tweezers, snip it off till it's about that long, dip it in some 5-minute epoxy and then stick it down there and do that in clumps. I think it looks a little bit more realistic.
Okay.
And I'll show you some of that here on some of these other ones in a minute. This I just made with a Dr. Pepper can, and I made a little fixture out of some sheet styrene, half round sheet styrene, two pieces of it so that they'd overlap like this, and you just squeeze it with pliers and it forms this corrugated look. If I do it again, I'll have to do something different, because once you've got corrugated aluminum, trying to get it to roll, nearly impossible. So that's why it's all crinkled up. But it does look like it's been run over by a truck, so I count that.
That might be a good idea.
And then I made these little cabbages. I made a little leaf stamp out of this piece of sheet styrene. And it's a little chunk of sheet styrene about that big. And I carved what looks like a little leaf in it. It didn't have to be perfect. Just sit there and use an X-Acto knife to carve what looked like a leaf on there. I'd roll out some Aves. You guys ever use Aves? Okay, what do you use when you use putty?
Is that two-party
putty? It's a two-party epoxy putty.
A black and white putty?
Yeah, well, it comes in different colors. It's a really good epoxy clay putty. It's two-part. It's very forgiving. It's non-toxic. It even smells like corn chips. It doesn't taste like corn chips.
We had tried, but...
Yeah, so I've heard. And, just stamped out some leaves, peel them up off a piece of wax paper, and then wrap them around a little bead. And then, before too long, you know, after about 2 hours, I've got enough cabbages to fill up a diorama. Mm-hmm. I'll be pouring water in here sooner or later.
Well, that looks like you've already got dirt in there.
Yeah, I got a bunch of dirt in there that's washed up in through there.
Now, what'd you use to carve out your foam?
I used a razor saw.
Razor saw.
Yeah, and then once it was more or less the shape, I take some of those foam sanding sponges like you get at the hardware store and just sand it smooth.
Okay.
And then once I got that on, I took some, 40,000 sheet styrene and just glued it on with 5-minute epoxy.
Okay.
Yeah. And then once I got that on, I carved everything as close as I could to the edge so it would blend in. Mm-hmm. I'll bring the groundwork up next to it.
For sure.
So that it looks... that was my first attempt at trying to follow Uncle Sunnightshift's advice. I don't know if I succeeded too well. It fits the model really well, but I wish I'd had a little bit more of a lump right over here. Mm. It looks kind of too flat to me. But it is a farmland, so.
Now, I run Red Gator for a living on country roads.
Yeah.
And that looks so real.
Does
right
it?
In this area.
Yeah.
Because I see culverts every day.
It looks
very
okay.
Impressive. Yeah.
Okay, thanks.
Looks really good.
Thank you very much. Once I got all that done, I painted everything. I prefer to use a dark brown primer to create artificial shadows, especially on groundwork, because it looks more natural. So that when you go back and start painting, the rest of the groundwork with your washes, your airbrush, drop-on washes, and maybe touch up some of those rocks and things like that, those artificial shadows don't look black and chalky. They look like dirt. They look natural. Mm-hmm.
And are you playing acrylics because you have that foam base?
Once I got the Mod Podge and
that
mud on there, that
separate.
Took care of everything.
Okay.
Yeah, so I could use whatever I wanted. So some of this is acrylic. There's some enamels and stuff on there,
okay.
too. But I used to use enamels almost exclusively. I've started switching to acrylics because enamels are getting harder to find.
Mm-hmm.
And I've got a lot of acrylics now, so. This is the metal on this is enamel.
Okay.
And I think some of the other washes and things that I put on here are enamel washes. It's been 2 years since I built this, so I'm trying to remember. I'll build up the color with the airbrush and maybe with a hairy stick until I get it lighter and lighter in the way I like it. Where the airbrush has overspray, I'll go back in there with a wash of like oil with some terpenoid and then flow that in and kind of hide the overspray. And then just build it up that way. This one I'm kind of proud of for my first base of this type. Mm-hmm. Since then I've done a lot of others that are like this, but a lot smaller. And I will go into some of that too. Let's see. I'll take this. Show you. This out of the way. Okay. Hi.
Hi, how's it going?
Good, how you doing?
Good, good.
Yeah, stick that up there. Let me move this out of the way so it's easier. So this is one of the next ones I did, and in this case, I just used a sheet of styrene to start the base with, cut out like 80,000 styrene, and I built up a mound of Abe's epoxy sculpt to form the, you know, the basis of it, and I mixed that up with some dirt as well. Mm-hmm. Just took a bunch of that, like I said, dirt from the garden, folded it into the Aves, into the epoxy clay, so that it got really muddy and pebbly. Threw in some pebbles and stuff in there too, and painted everything up. Then I made some cattails. I made those out of a piece of wire and then rolled up putty. And then the leaves, the reeds, are just typing paper. Okay. Nothing special about that. You know, I just cut out, like, take a piece of typing paper and just kind of cut it out in, like, a shape of a W, you know, and then roll it up around the stalk on the reeds. And then put a wash of green Vallejo acrylic paint, and that got the paper wet, and the paper curled up and kind of bent and folded and stained the paper, and it looks just like reeds. It looks really good.
That's all you did?
That's all I did, yeah.
That looks pretty good.
So, the water alone caused that from being stiff paper to looking like grass. Well, that worked out really well too.
Was that planned?
Yeah, it was planned. I was hoping that it would do it that way. I figured, let's give this a shot. If it doesn't work, I'm going to have to try something else. But I was lucky that it worked.
And these were probably bent in different ways, so no two leaves are alike.
Yes, exactly. They bent in different ways. I could fold them over. I could break them. I could tear them. And they just, and then add a little bit more water to that. You know, just, it's not so much, I didn't really do a lot of thick paint. It's just a wash of, like, greens and browns.
Just enough to turn the white to green.
Yeah, turn the white to green and then to cause it to fold up naturally. And I thought it looked pretty well. Again, when I was talking about taking clumps of static grass, I just take a big chunk of static grass, fronds of different sizes, and I hold it in a pair of needle nose tweezers, snip off the top, snip off the bottom, so that they're about 3/16 of an inch tall, dip it in some 5-minute epoxy, stick it on there, and go on and do that over and over and over again. And that, you see where the clumps of grass look a lot better than that static grass did, I think. Looks more natural.
You did that for about 5 minutes, right?
Yeah, until I run out of glue and I mix up some more and after a couple of hours, you're all right.
So now, is this colored port epoxy on this side then?
Yeah.
The clear?
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah, what I did was, painted everything, again, with, this time I just used a brush, painted everything, airbrush it with that mahogany surfacer color, that dark brown, and then go in and paint everything with a brush so that it looks good that way. Did a little bit of airbrush work on that, but not much. And then also use some oil stains and things like that. I just use regular artist oils and terpenoid to flow it in there. And it gives a much more lively color than acrylics, I think. Once everything's done, wrap it up with just a chunk of plastic, put a little bit of Vaseline on there, tape that all closed, and pour some of this water in. That's the water I've been using,
Okay.
just because of what I had available. I've never tried anything before, and I didn't want to spend $100 on it. On water until I knew what I was doing.
Mm-hmm. Where'd you get this at?
I think I got it at Michael's. Yeah. Oh. Michael's a Hobby Lobby, I don't remember.
Paint used to color it then? Or?
Yeah. And then I put like a couple of drops of, I put Vallejo green in there, just a couple of drops in there. That seemed to be almost too much. And the other thing is it didn't mix in very well. It kind of, it smeared around. It took me a long time to get it to mix in right. So I'm thinking of maybe trying inks or something like that.
Do you think a lacquer would go in there better?
Pardon?
Do you think a lacquer would mix with that epoxy better? Or?
I don't know. I really don't know. I'm gonna have to experiment with it. I do like the way the color turned out on that.
Yeah.
But I wish it wasn't quite so opaque. You know, there's just two drops of paint made that really, really opaque. You can still see through it, but I'd prefer if it had been a little clearer.
Is that water-based, that easy cast?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, okay. Did you use acrylics? Is that, I missed what you said on the color of acrylics?
Yeah. Yeah, acrylics
so
and oils.
Blend in. Nice. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yeah, it was just a couple of drops of Vallejo acrylic in that water.
So in hindsight, you would have just put in less...
Yeah, in hindsight, I might put on just like take a toothpick and stick it in the in there and stir it up with that, and that would be enough. Even less than one drop, you know.
Is there like liquid?
It's
like water.
It's like syrup.
Like
it has a consistency of maple syrup, and it leaves a really big meniscus on it. You know, meniscus stands up around the edges, pretty tall. So I have to carve all that stuff off.
What's meniscus?
It's you know when you pour something in it around the edges where it leaves a little lip.
Oh,
it's
like
called
foam?
A meniscus. No, it's not foam. It's like
just a concrete surface.
Just holds onto the wall.
If you look at like
gravity.
You look at inside of a cup, you see how the water as it goes up to the edge, it kind of flows up the side. Just a little bit, like a little ski tip.
So he would have had a sharp edge around the edge.
Yeah. So I had a heavy meniscus on that, and I had to cut that away. And then once I got that cut away, I took some heavy.
Which was a cutter?
Exacto knife. Exacto knife, and in some cases I was able to get a Dremel tool in there and just mow it down. But
was it hardened yet, or?
It was all hard. Yeah, you have to wait until it's all hard. And once it's cured, then it's easy enough to cut away, but it's tough, so you run the risk of slicing your fingers off. It's okay, they'll grow back.
It only happens when you get put a new blade on, though.
No, it only happens when you get an old blade. The new blade slices just fine. So yeah, use a new blade. Anyway, then on top of that, I put some clear acrylic gel medium. It's this thick gel medium you can get, again, from the hobby, or not the hobby shop, the art supply store, Michael's or whatever. And I would sculpt that stuff on it. It goes on white. It looks like, it's not white glue. It doesn't look like PVA. It's acrylic, but it goes on white and it obscures everything. And after about an hour and a half, it dries clear. It's not completely glossy clear, but it's pretty good. And you can add another layer on top of it. Then, once that's all completely dry, to get that shine, I just use Future. I assume you guys use Future on like windows and things like that. Well, that works for water too. Just brush on some water or some Future. It will re-emulsify that clear acrylic gel and turn it white again for another 15 or 20 minutes, but it'll turn glossy, perfectly glass clear after that. When you put that on and you see it turn white, don't worry, it goes back to
That's
clear.
That's why I'm at these kinds of workshops, because I've been panicking when that happens.
Yeah. Well, and it's especially difficult because you've just put weeks or months of work into a model, and now you're going to ruin it by pouring resin all over. And if it doesn't work, you're out all that time, and you can't go back. Unlike, if you goof up on painting or something, you can stick it under the sink and scrub it off with a toothbrush.
Yep.
If you mix up with pouring water, you're done. That's the end of that model. It goes into the trash can and you start something else. So,
the future is that floor wax, right?
Pardon?
Future is floor wrap.
Yeah.
Full polish. Sell that up on a hard.
Well, I don't. They sell it under a different name, and I don't know what it's called anymore.
Yeah,
I don't.
But
keep
they
track
also
of
have
it.
Gone to give you all these kinds of other ways to apply it. The good old bottle, I've had a hard time finding.
I have two bottles that I bought, like 20 years ago.
Yeah.
And they're still about 3/4 full or half full because I don't use that much of it.
No, they usually, but. I moved every other year. Oh, yeah. Movers don't like moving it.
Yeah.
So then I had to leave it behind, and then I came here, and I went everywhere.
Where did they go? Yeah. Yeah, I think it's called Pledge with Future Shine or something like that these days.
And keep it out of the sun.
Yeah, keep it out of the sun. I keep it in the garage. I keep it in the garage.
I've burned cars.
Along with my...
I was pretty sure
boxes of matches and cans of oily rags and things like that. So,
so it all goes up at once.
Yeah.
You know, future seems kind of old school. You know, but aren't the new varnishes better? No, I'm just
some
asking.
Some of them might be.
Question.
Yeah. I'm not qualified to answer that. Maybe you would. If you used them between the two, you'd be able to tell better. I know a lot of people do use the newer glossy varnishes, and they work great. I think Alclad's Aqua Gloss Clear is really nice, but I've never tried it on something like this.
Yeah. What I appreciate with Pledge or the Future is that it actually self-levels.
Right,
don't have that. So if you don't spray on right, like the varnishes and stuff, you'll have that problem. It self-heals itself.
So it takes a while to cure out.
When I do automotive cars, I dip it in glass, let it sit about 2 minutes, and then wick it off.
Yeah. Glass, it self-levels right off. Yeah. I've noticed the same thing when I've done glass canopies.
It's meant for fours. It has to level out.
You buff it then?
Yeah, you can buff it.
And that's it, man. You do the canopies with it. You get, what, 20 years
of... You can also remove it, too.
Exactly. And it'll last me the rest of my life.
I'm going to show much water people me. That'll be just fine. Price anyway. Everything gets so expensive. I'm thinking that works just fine.
And they build a kit, and then, I need some groundwork in it. Go to Colfar, $150 later, it's like, wow.
You know,
my garden next.
I would definitely agree that going into the garden, you know, go down to King Supers or, you know, the grocery store and get a sifter, you know, like a kitchen sifter, and just hang it up in your garage or in your modeling space.
Go to the Goodwill store and get it for $2.
Exactly. Yeah. And it's $1.99 or something like that. And then you can just go out in the backyard and scoop up a bunch of dirt, and you'll have enough dirt to last you for years out of like two or three sifting scoops, you know. It'll be good. And then the dirt looks like dirt. The only problem that you're going to have with it is you have to fix it, and I recommend you definitely paint it. Don't leave it as just dirt color. You want to paint it, because if it's just dirt, it might grow mold. It might grow bacteria. Mm. It might attract ants.
Yeah, it's organic.
You know, but the ants aren't going to like the flavor of the primer, so they're going to leave it alone. Yeah. And then you get more control over the finished product anyway. You get that, you know, it won't look like scale. Dirt won't look like scale dirt. You have to paint it. You have to, you know, improve it. If you want static grass, you can buy static grass from Urban Scenics for like, you know, $12 for a bag of it, or you can buy some old paintbrushes. Or, you know, some paintbrushes down at the hardware store and snip those off. It's not quite as thin and quite as fine. So it's up to you which ones you want to do. Again, static grass will last you a long time. I'll grab a whole bunch of little pebbles and things.
Material off, like, the bottom of your bumper after muddy road, most of that is fines, and different colors. You travel different places, reds and yellows and whatnot.
Yeah, there's
this really fine sifter.
Here's just Woodland Scenic static grass that I
don't
use.
Don't without it.
Chop it off, and then grab a tweezer full of this stuff, and then trim it to the size that I want, and glue it in place. And I bought that, I don't know, 18, 17 years ago, and I still got most of it.
Remember, that was impossible to find.
Yeah, I think I got that at Caboose.
Yeah.
Back when it was still around.
Oh, it's gone now?
Yeah, Caboose is gone. It's really sad. It's just dirt. Just the regular sifted fine dirt, you know. In a couple of, you know, I'll sift some of the heavier stuff out and put it in a different tin. I don't have much left in this. You know what that stuff is?
The good stuff.
Yeah.
Cat litter?
Cat litter, yes. Mm. So I take cat litter, put it in a mortar and pestle, grind it up into fine little rocks, and that really helps. I recommend you use fresh cat litter.
There's only so much saving money you should do.
There's only so much saving money. Yeah, that's right. You got it. Once I've Once I've sifted out the dirt, I'll save some of the pebbles because they can always come in handy.
I mean, that's what you get when you go in the yard.
Yeah, that's the mix up. But always remember to paint them. You know, again, they don't look like scales or boulders. They look like pebbles. Yeah, there you go. Yeah. Another thing that I like to do is
you give them color. You know,
yeah, I will airbrush a primer coat over them. I like to use Mr. Surfacer Mahogany. Again, because of that brownish color. I've used black before, I've used gray before. But on these bases, the mahogany is really, really nice. It really adds that natural undertone to things. So that when you put your washes over the top of them, keep your paint thin, and it really looks natural. Another thing I like to use is cork. It's just chunks of cork like this, or I'll grind it up into little tiny pieces. I see a lot of people on gaming minis will take a chunk of cork and lay it down and say, that looks like asphalt. Well, it looks a little bit like asphalt, but it really looks like cork. So it'd be best to continue to work it before you just put your car on a piece of cork and call it good. I have a couple of other examples here. This lady here, where I blended her into, again, took a piece of styrofoam, that's actually one of the many bases. Blended her in, did the same thing, took some eggs and some chunks of cork. You can't see the cork underneath there anymore unless you really know what you're looking for. But then, yeah, base added some level to that with the cork, troweled in some of that age, painted everything up. Well, before I painted everything up, I folded in the roots and things like that into it. Again, just using little noodles of putty or actual roots, like, you know, grass roots, really thin little roots. Glue those in place. Stick some of that static grass under there, and I made some little flowers for her.
What'd you make flowers out of?
The flowers, I have a few right here.
Oh, these look purple in the sand.
Yeah. There's, see if I can figure out what I did with them. They're around here somewhere. Anyway, what I did with the flowers.
There's more Elkhart's boxes back there.
Oh, there's another one right there. One jar. Itty bitty flowers.
You never really struggle with that breath, huh?
So what I did here with these,
like, would you like a breath mint?
No,
honestly. Do you want a breath mint?
Really?
Minimum of three.
Oh, wow.
So what I did with those is I just took a drill and I punched out some little chunks of paper with the back end of the drill. You know, stick like a piece of paper onto a piece of solid paper, like that. It's about an eighth of an inch in diameter. Takes exactly 9 inches. Poke a little hole in the middle of it and then just like slice some little slices out of it, right?
Okay.
And then I take an old toothbrush, snip a bristle off, hold it next to the candle flame so it mushrooms the head out, and I'd string that little flower up onto it.
Okay.
And then it's like flat, you know, it just looks like that. And I'd put a couple of those like that on there.
Okay.
And then again, I did the same thing where you hit it with a drop of, hesitate to call it paint, more like dirty water with like some of that Vallejo thinner in it.
Yeah.
And then
straight paint, you just keep killing.
Right, yeah. It just looks like painted. So that does the same thing as what it did with this. It folded those things up so they look like flower petals and kind of like just paint that toothbrush bristle with a little green and just glue those in place all over the base.
Piece of paper.
And I thought that would take forever.